This episode is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Use our link in the description below for a 30-day trial, giving you unlimited access to thousands of documentaries and nonfiction titles from some of the world's best filmmakers when you use the code INFOGRAPHICS. At 6:45 a.m. on March 1, 1954, the Earth rumbled and shook. A massive crater was formed in the Pacific Ocean as the largest hydrogen bomb to ever go off made its fateful detonation. An orange and yellow explosion that could be described as glorious shot up a cloud of radioactive debris that stretched 4.5 miles wide and 130,000 feet high into the sky above Bikini Atoll, a tiny island that's part of the Marshall Islands. It left a crater in the ocean floor with a diameter of 6,510 feet and a depth of 250 feet. Just to give you an idea of its magnitude, that's more than 18 football fields wide and almost an entire one deep. This lethal debris was still falling about 5 hours later on Rongelap, an atoll 97 miles away, where it came down like ashy snow, so naturally, kids played in it and even went so far as to eat it. This is the story of Castle Bravo, the thermal nuclear accident that ended up being 1,000 times more powerful than Hiroshima. Castle Bravo was the codename for what was ironically called the Shrimp, a device that weighed 23,500 pounds and was based on the Teller-Ulam thermal nuclear weapon design, named after scientist Edward Teller and mathematician Stanislaw Ulam. Basically, the two set out to create a weapon that could be delivered by an aircraft. Its design was novel because its different parts were linked and each part of the sequence was intended to be powered by the part preceding it. This means that if one of the first elements failed, so too would all of the subsequent stages, rendering the device useless. Sort of a high-stakes dominoes. This design was supposed to be an upgrade from Ivy Mike, a previous bomb model tested in 1952 that had to be the size of a small building to support the equipment that allowed its fuel to stay in necessary liquid form. So, not convenient at all. Bravo used solid lithium deuteride, which meant none of this clunky equipment was necessary for it to retain its form. Bravo was the first part of Operation Castle, a mission that spanned 2.5 months and was the US's attempt to gather information on nuclear weapons. They specifically wanted to focus on the shock the weapons generated, their blast radius, and preceding fallout. Operation Castle was a small part of a much bigger, secretive arms race between the US and the Soviet Union in the 1950s. In 1950, the US National Security Council released NSC 68, which was a 68-page secret paper that suggested quadrupling defense spending in the case the Soviets attacked. Adding to the secrecy, classified studies at the time projected that by 1958 the US wouldn't be able to retaliate against the Soviets in the case of an attack. Back to Castle Bravo, though. It exploded at 15 megatons, which was, well, slightly higher than the scientists had originally projected. In fact, it was a whopping 2.5 times more intense than they had anticipated and can be attributed to some seriously complicated scientific miscalculations. Essentially, what happened was that scientists at the time didn't realize that the solid source of fusion fuel we mentioned earlier, a lithium deuteride, would react the way it did in this extreme situation. And as it turns out, a tiny scientific mistake can have almost unfathomable results. An area of 7,000 miles surrounding Bikini Atoll was contaminated, most notably the atolls of Rongelap and Uterik, and they felt the effects of radioactive poison almost immediately and for decades afterward. Radioactive material was spread to different parts all over the world, too, later found in Japan, India, Australia, Europe, and the United States. Bravo's dangerous rain was mostly made up of pieces of coral, radioactive particles, and water. Alex Wellerstein, a scientist at the Stevens Institute of Technology, noted in a 2013 blog post that what most likely happened during Bravo was that small particles went up with the fireball and stayed aloft long enough to lose most of their radioactive energy and diffuse into the atmosphere, while heavy particles fell right back down again pretty quickly. So blowing up and irradiating something like coral is just the worst possible thing, he wrote. The people of Rongelap weren't evacuated until 3 days after the blast, an eternity to be exposed to so much dangerous radioactive material lingering in the air. They were exposed to radiation of 60 to 300 rem. Rem stands for one dose of radiation exposure. 5 to 10 of these alone are enough to change a person's blood chemistry. 400 units could wipe out half of an exposed population. To add to this, in studies as recently as 2010, the National Cancer Institute determined that almost 170 cancer cases among residents of the Marshall Islands who were alive between 1948 and 1970 could be attributed to exposure to radiation. Not all of the reasons why Castle Bravo went horribly wrong were due to scientific miscalculations, though, but in fact were caused by deception, negligence, and a combination of the two. The winds were much more intense than scientists previously thought before carrying out the test. They concluded that the winds were suitable 3 days before the bomb, but a really irresponsible duo, Major General Percy Clarkson, head of the military team that carried out the test, and the scientific director Dr. Alvin Graves, still went through with the plan even though the winds were recognized as unfavorable just 6 hours before the blast. The USS Curtis, a Navy ship, was 23 miles from the detonation. Writing for Medium, military historian Paul Richard helped us to picture what the day was like for the men on that ship, noting that the heat was like having a blowtorch applied to their bodies. Ouch. It's impossible to talk about Castle Bravo without mentioning Lucky Dragon No. 5, a Japanese tuna fishing boat with a 23-man crew that was about 80 miles away from Bikini Atoll when the test happened. According to a documentary for the Maryland History Day competition, the men on the boat witnessed the sun rise mysteriously in the west and heard a symphony of thunder and snow falling out of the sky. About an hour and a half after the initial explosion, one crew member died from the exposure and the others had adverse health effects as a result. One of these fishermen, Oishi Matsushishi, remembered and described the Armageddon-like scene like this. A yellow flash poured through the porthole. Wondering what happened, I jumped up from the bunk near the door, ran out on the dock, and was astonished. Bridge, sky, and sea burst into view, painted in flaming sunset colors. I looked around in a daze. I was totally at a loss. Lucky Dragon also sparked international worry over the radioactive tuna that was aboard the boat when the bomb exploded. The Japanese called the whole event a second Hiroshima. They also almost severed ties with the US as a result. The US government doctor sent to Japan to help after the incident wrongly predicted that those on the boat would recover in a month. 6 months later, Aikichi Kubayama, the Lucky Dragon's 40-year-old radio operator, succumbed to the damage caused by the radioactivity and died, leading to the New York Times naming him probably the world's first hydrogen bomb casualty. Lucky Dragon also had a profound effect on how the Castle Bravo narrative was framed. In a 2002 interview, physicist Ralph Lapp attributed Lucky Dragon as the singular event that made the US look bad, saying the story of the Lucky Dragon blew the lid off of secrecy because the Atomic Energy Commission could not keep it a secret. The story had to be told because radioactivity persisted and could deny territory to normal use. Furthermore, there was the fact that some of the chemicals in the fallout were highly toxic fission products, and this could be a health hazard. At this point, you might be wondering what happened to the people who were exposed to that fallout. Unfortunately, the reality of what happened was much more grim than anything that could be conjured up for a riveting science fiction movie. The US attempted to redeem themselves after the calamity, but they still managed to screw things up and cause even more long-term damage. Because the people of Rongelap were among those hit the hardest, they became the test subjects of a government-funded project called Project 4.1, more specifically named the Study of Response of Human Beings Exposed to Significant Beta and Gamma Radiation Due to the Fallout from High-Yield Weapons, which took place a week after Bravo. The Rongelapese people weren't given a translator to break down what was going on, so they were essentially being tested on without proper consent. They were given medication without being told why they should take them. Pregnant women who were exposed to radiation eventually gave birth to deformed babies, some of which included larger than normal heads and opaque skin. None of these babies survived more than a few days after being born. Thyroid tumors, especially among the Rongelapese women, caused them to need corrective surgeries, which limited their abilities to speak and sing, a devastating side effect since singing is a revered part of Marshallese culture that goes back hundreds of years. Troy de Broome, who would later become the foreign minister to the Marshall Islands, was 9 years old during Bravo. From his perspective as just a kid, he remembered a flash of light, silent and brighter than the sun, and then watched the sky turn red as blood. That memory drove him in later years to make it his life's mission to fight for the injustices that happened to his people. To a crowd at the United Nations in 2005, he said, "United States government documents clearly demonstrate that its scientists conducted human radiation experiments with Marshallese citizens. Some of our people were injected with or were coerced to drink fluids laced with radiation. Other experiments involved the resettling of people on islands highly contaminated to study how human beings absorbed radiation from the food and environment." You could say Tony de Broome was the Marshall Islands' hero. He helped the islands become independent of the United States in 1979, and even helped file a lawsuit against the US for violating a treaty on nuclear non-proliferation. So Tony really wasn't messing around. You think the Castle Bravo disaster would be enough to stop nuclear bomb testing altogether, but Operation Castle continued on, with a total of 67 nuclear weapons tested in the Pacific Ocean. The other five parts of the operation were named Romeo, Coon, Union, Yankee, and Nectar. It finally came to a semblance of an end with the Limited Test Ban Treaty, which was signed and passed in 1963. It required that any and all tests be done underground, but it looks like there is some hope. Ever since 1992, the United States has relied on simulations of nuclear weapons instead of the real thing. The Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, which would forbid any nuclear tests, garnered signatures from 184 countries in 1996. So while Castle Bravo led to a series of seemingly irreparable mistakes, there is a light at the end of the long, long tunnel that this won't ever happen again. We want to give a huge thank you to today's sponsor, CuriosityStream. We know you love to learn just as much as we do, and there's no better place to get the highest quality documentaries and nonfiction titles than on the streaming service created for those with a lifelong quest to learn, explore, and understand. We just watched How to Build a Castle, and not only did we learn a ton, now we're ready to build one of our own. With thousands of videos across science, nature, history, and more, you'll never run out of new topics to explore. You can get unlimited access for just $2.99 a month or $19.99 a year, and for viewers of the Infographics Show, the first 30 days are completely free if you sign up at curiositystream.com/infographics and use the code INFOGRAPHICS. Now, if you want more of these similar videos, go watch our video, The Only Man to Survive Two Nuclear Bombs. Go watch it now. You won't regret it. See you next time.